With COVID cases rising in numbers every day and the holiday quickly approaching, stressful time for everyone preparing for this holiday season. And joining us again today is Graham Briggs, Director of Olmsted County Public Health, to discuss where we are now and how we can come together as a community to fight this virus. Welcome, Graham.
Thanks, Danielle. It's good to be back.
I'm so glad to be connected with you, especially during a pandemic, but how unfortunate that this is a segue of how we actually met.
Yeah, I feel like it was one of the last times I went out in public into a public setting. And so we'll always have that memory, I think, long after the pandemic.
It will. And I remember asking you about it because so much was unknown at that time. How are you doing right now, Graham, and your team? And I also want to know if you all have toilet paper, because those are not on the shelf right now.
Yeah, unfortunately, we don't get any like secret information ahead of time through a top secret channel. Well, yeah, ever since that first go around, I think just personally, my family, we've tried to stay a little bit more stocked up. This is probably like, you're your grandmother that hid our cash under the bed or whatever from the grew up in the Depression. You know, there's always that story. Our whole lives now, we'll probably have like closets full of toilet paper. You know, that's just something we'll carry with us, you know, forever out of this pandemic. But so we're stocked here. If anybody needs to borrow a roll, let me know and I'm happy to help out. But I think as far as the team goes and the response goes, you know, over the months, as we've talked a couple of times now, this has really evolved from that first time that we got to sit down and talk about just general virology and what was happening to the last time we talked. You know, we were remote, but the situation was, you know, was under control. We're right in the thick of what is a first wave through this community now, through the Midwest, and I'm sure everybody watching, you know, I've seen the numbers as far as the states around us go, and Minnesota and Olmsted County as well. So, you know, we're 8-9 months into this now. I think we've learned a lot about COVID. We've got a lot of staff that have worked about 3 years worth of work in the last 8 months or so. So I think we're as sick of it as everybody else is in the public. You know, I've got a couple of kids home right now that just went to distance learning. And so I think all of us are doing our best to make it through, but we're ready to, you know, to get out of this here at some point in the near future. So so we're hanging in there. We're working hard, doing everything we can, and going to get through it, but they're tired.
Yeah, and I can definitely relate in that regard. As you mentioned, Graham, we are in a COVID surge. What's the status of positive COVID cases and ICU bed availability?
Well, Minnesota overall is doing a little bit better than some of the states around us right now. Wisconsin has had to set up some field clinics. Iowa is basically out of beds. North Dakota is converting a hospital to a COVID-specific facility right now. And we're tight on hospital beds in the state. The last time I saw, I think it's 92 or 93% of our ICU beds are taken up. But we have had some time, I think, both at the state level and working with Mayo, to really add some flexibility in there and be able to add beds and things like that. So while we're strained, I think we've still got some room here. That's the good news. I think the bad news here is that at any time with COVID-19, the cases that we're seeing today, we're always looking backwards about 2 weeks, you know, with the cases that we're seeing, or you know, more like 3 weeks or a little bit longer with the hospitalizations that we're seeing. And so right now in Minnesota, and that includes in Olmsted County, the number of people being admitted to the hospital for COVID every day is increasing fairly rapidly. And that also means the number of people that are in hospital beds every day is also going up pretty quickly right now, right here with Olmsted residents. And so these next couple of weeks, unfortunately, the people that are going to end up in the hospital have already been exposed. They might not be sick yet, but that future is written for us, unfortunately. And I would expect that that trend is continuing here over the next couple of weeks, where we see more and more strain on the hospital system. And so while I think Minnesota's as prepared as we could be, we're going to text the system, and I'm hoping it hangs on here. But what we really need, I think, help from the public right now is that while these next 2 weeks are determined, and you know, there might be enough capacity here, if this exponential acceleration continues, I'm hoping people are kind of getting used to seeing that line going straight up. That means you were talking about this 2 becomes 4, becomes 8, becomes 16. We're in that sort of acceleration right now. And so if the community really makes these changes now, some of them obviously being imposed by the governor right now to make large changes in our community, but just people, you know, doing poker night at home or not having that friend over, that's where we're seeing a lot of transmission right now. And then it goes into whole households from there.
Graham, can we talk about that for a second? Governor Walz shared about the increase in positive COVID cases, as you had mentioned, and that is accelerating, that we're getting close to that 300,000 mark. Thanksgiving is right around the corner. What are your thoughts on how to convince people to help pitch in and social distance and minimize those gatherings?
I think that's the big thing right now, is once we get out a few weeks, or, you know, decisions that people are making right now are going to help reduce that burden that we're seeing on both the public health system and the medical system. I think a lot of us in the field of public health around this nation right now are concerned that Thanksgiving is one of those holidays that you bring the college students and the grandparents and the aunts and uncles all together. And that is exactly the opposite of what we want to do in the middle of a pandemic, you know, where we can see a lot of transmission here in this community right now, and potentially people at high risk. So if we're going to ask the community to do something, it's starting right now, doing whatever we can to stay just with the people that you live with whenever possible, and avoid any sorts of groups of people or even having that friend or two over. And then for Thanksgiving, ultimately, you know, it's up to people to make that call. But my recommendation would be, this is the year that you do Thanksgiving virtually, knowing by doing that, you can make sure everybody's at the table next year, when you can have an extra special 2-turkey Thanksgiving or something like that next year with everybody there.
Yeah, and a lot of people have mentioned that, you know, maybe next July, you know, the 4th of July will be, you know, good enough for and safe enough for everybody to get together during that holiday and just have all the holidays at once, which I thought was a really good idea. Graham, you had mentioned vaccine, and it is being mass produced. Planning is underway, but it's going to be a phased approach. What is Olmsted County's strategy with the vaccine distribution, and will the vaccine be administered in a phased approach as well locally?
Right, that's a good question. I think we're just weeks away now from vaccine. It's likely that people are going to be getting vaccinated right here in Olmsted County, probably before the end of the year or right around there. So the vaccine coming, though, to start is going to be very limited as it gets pushed out all across the country. So we do have priority groups. I think the first groups that we're really looking at are ICU and emergency departments and long-term care, and making sure that we've got vulnerable populations and the people that we need to be healthy so they can take care of all of us as a community healthy. After that, we start getting into some other priority populations that would be next in line, like looking at people that have chronic underlying health conditions or might be a little bit older. They may be able to get to the head of the line. And over the coming months, vaccine will become more and more available. But to start with, we'll definitely want to be looking at those populations where we can really help protect the people that need it most.
And can people trust the vaccine? There's a lot of misinformation on social media, what's being distributed, questioning the validity of it, if it's safe. Is it safe, Graham?
Yeah, both the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines that are both about to get approved here are making data available. Something that Minnesota has talked about with a number of other states is that if there are concerns about politics involved in that sort of thing, that Minnesota wants to make sure as a state that third-party experts are able to vet the data, understand it, make sure it looks the way it's supposed to look, and give a stamp of approval. And everything that we're hearing on our side is that these are both of these first two that are about to come out of clinical trials and be available are looking very promising, and the data is indicating both that this is very safe and it's very effective, which we expected it to be safe. That's something that we want to make sure, and just make sure no corners were cut or anything like that. Everything's staying safe. We're surprised at how effective it is. We thought 60-70% would be good. These are looking at like they're more like 95% effective, which is outstanding.
And it looks like the vaccine requires two times to be administered. Is that correct? Is that just for one vaccine, the Pfizer?
Yeah, these first two that are coming out, it's a new vaccine platform called an mRNA vaccine. And the thought is on both of those, people are going to need two doses. That's not necessarily true with vaccines that are still in the pipeline, but not quite as far. So Johnson & Johnson's vaccine, which would be more of a vaccine that we're used to, or the type that we have made in the past, it's possible that might be one dose, but the clinical trials will help determine that for sure. But these first two, yeah, it looks like probably two doses.
The executive orders has posed challenges again. There's not a bridged federal stimulus. Small businesses are greatly impacted, and I know that team works with many businesses across the community to make sure that, you know, there's people can go there and transmissions are reduced, at least the risk. What are some ways that the community can come together and small businesses can be supported through this with the challenge of a mandate like this?
Yeah, I think, you know, we're just as concerned, I think, at the public health department about our individual residents as we are about our local businesses, and want to make sure that we're doing whatever we can to try to weather this, recognizing the difficulties that they've got, and whether it's CARES grant dollars or trying to get creative and working with local businesses. You know, I think we've built a relationship that hasn't been there as much in the past with the local Chamber of Commerce. And I actually just was texting with Holly Masick a little bit earlier today about, you know, how can we be creative and do through events or do things safely. And so we've got staff that have become COVID experts over the last few months here, and are really trying to work with these local businesses to get creative. That would be my advice, I think, to the community is, let's all come together and figure out ways that we can do things like drive-through events where we can do them safely, get out of our houses, because I'm here in my basement. Yeah, we're all sick of doing this. If we can do it, get out of the house, stay safe, and support local business at the same time, you know, I'm all for doing whatever we can to help make that happen. And really, at this point, it's a bridge. You know, the governor's executive orders are in place because we're going through a spike here. That's not going to last forever. And as vaccine becomes more available, we're going to have much more flexibility as time goes by here. But in the meantime, right now, a few weeks of, you know, doing a drive-through event to pick up food or something like that sounds great to me if we can figure out how to do it.
I agree. Many organizations and businesses have adapted in the midst of a pandemic and how they deliver their business model, their offerings, their services. I agree that, you know, adapting is a good thing. It's a challenge for some small businesses, though. What is your recommendation moving past the holidays into next year as people continue to get pandemic fatigue? How do we keep inspiring people to just stay safe?
I think as we go through the winter months, one thing we've been talking about is trying to take advantage of open spaces. You know, this is that winter where, you know, in this COVID year, avoiding big groups for Thanksgiving is a thing that we'll never have to see again. But it can also be the start of something where if you've never gone cross-country skiing. This is the winter to learn how to do that. You can do it safely. You can get out of the house. You can get exercise and go snowshoeing or doing things like that that allow people to get out of the funk that is easy to get into, you know, with just sitting in front of a computer, working from home, all that sort of thing. So I think just to get through the winter months, being creative and potentially, you know, for those that haven't tried something new outside and taking advantage of the parks and the open spaces that we've got here in Rochester that is one thing we have a lot of is space, support, access to country skis, you know, and that sort of thing. So by the time that snow melts, it's very realistic, and I would say probable at this point, that a significant piece of the population is vaccinated. And it's clear, you know, at that point that, you know, things are opening back up, and it's possible that, you know, we're talking about, you know, kids being in school, you know, and other things like that that are going to start feeling more and more normal. The further we get into 2021, the more so this is going to start looking like something that's manageable, and we're going to be able to walk our way out of.
Mm-hmm. It seems like people are good ideas. I learned to, you know, snowshoe last year was a blast, and I agree having those outlets. It seems some people are really struggling with a pandemic and at home and that sort of thing. And so, you know, certainly those well-being sources are absolutely needed right now to bridge that, you know, and for the mental and emotional health support during this time.
Yeah, I think one thing we understand is that this virus is doing a lot more than just infecting people. It's impacting our economy, it's impacting our jobs, financial stability, mental health, our children. You know, so much is being touched by this virus beyond just infection community. And so I think that's something that we're thinking at the health department about and looking at wellness overall and access to behavioral and mental health services and things like that to become more and more important, I think, the further that we go. Again, I think with the light at the end of the tunnel, that starts getting better here pretty quickly. But we do want to be cognizant of the fact that there's people struggling, especially as we get into the winter months, and people struggle a little bit more when there's a little bit less light and a little bit less ability to get outdoors and get outside and get your vitamin D. So my recommendation, I think, for people would be to be aware of that and don't be afraid to look for some help or talk to some people if you need to about that sort of thing. It's to be expected, I think, in a situation where we're all stressed in a way that we've never been before. And it's expected that people are going to struggle with that. Myself included, we all are.
Yeah, absolutely. I know I have, you know, started to feel it too. And one way that I have bridged that is by being intentional about my connection with people. So I've started these virtual connection hangouts on Zoom with my girlfriends, and the next one I have is going to be a taco party.
I think I told you the last time I just had my first virtual hangout with some friends, a couple days before. So I have found out that my wife and I are both terrible teachers, and I have to applaud my wife though on the efforts that she's put in. Try to do distance learning and all that stuff, but boy, teachers deserve a lot of respect for the great work that they do.
Oh, absolutely. Teachers are one of the heroes of the hour, definitely, during the pandemic, for sure. I would not be hired as a teacher.
No, I would fail at that job.
Yeah, same here.
Epidemiologist, public health director, that's way easier than being
a teacher. There would be a mass walkout in my classroom. Yeah. What is your last parting advice to anybody that is really wanting to find those connections during the holidays?
I think this holiday season, we need to do virtual. It's the best way to show that you love the people that are closest to you is by staying away from them this holiday season. And to keep in mind that while all of us feel like this has been going on forever and will go on forever, the reality is that we are weeks away from vaccine in this country now. it's very likely that here in Olmsted County, we'll have people vaccinated before the end of the year. That changes the whole ball game. And over those next few months, as vaccine becomes more and more available, we're going to be able to get out of our houses and go back to normal lives and take masks off. So we want to ask people to bear down just a little while longer, because we're going to get to the end of this thing. It's just got to, we got to take a couple more tough steps here, I think, to get to the end of it.
Graham, that's really good advice. I hope that people heed it. We definitely want to see everybody on the other side of this, and we want people to remain healthy. Thank you so much for joining us today. Be well and stay safe, and we'll see you next time on Our Town, the show about Rochester. I'm so much stronger now. I'm so much stronger now.